In a famous moment during the Apollo 14 mission, an astronaut named Alan Shepard hit two golf balls off the surface of the moon. So in this video, we're actually going to do a projectile motion analysis for a golf ball hit on the moon, and we're expecting this thing to go pretty far because gravity is so much weaker on the moon. In fact, G on the moon is about 1/6 G on the Earth, or about 1.63 meters per second squared. Another cool thing about projectile motion on the moon is that our assumption that drag forces can be ignored is actually accurate because the moon has no appreciable atmosphere. So we're given a launch angle of 52 degrees and an initial speed of 41.5 meters per second for this flight, and we're going to answer four questions about the flight of the ball. First, we're going to get the flight time and then the range R, that's the horizontal distance traveled by the ball. Then we're going to focus on the top of the trajectory by finding the maximum height of the ball and the speed of the ball at the top. So to get started with the projectile motion analysis, it's critical that we break our launch velocity into components. And our x component is going to have a magnitude of 41.5 times the cosine of this launch angle of 52 degrees. And when we run the numbers on this, we get about 25.5 meters per second. Our y component, that's going to be 41.5 sine of 52 degrees, and that gives us about 32.7 meters per second. So this ball is initially headed to the right at 25.5 meters per second, and initially upward at 32.7 meters per second. Now we start looking at the questions, and we want to get the flight time of the golf ball. This is going to require an analysis of the y component of the motion. And in fact, we know the final y coordinate of the ball because we're on a level surface here. The final y coordinate is zero. And so we have that extra little bit of information in the y direction. That's a big clue that we need to do a y analysis here. So we're going to look at the kinematic equation that describes the y coordinate as a function of time. So that's y equals y naught plus v naught yt, where v naught y is the initial y velocity. And then in general, it's a plus 1/2 ay t squared. But we'll go ahead and put in an acceleration that we'll call negative g, where g is the magnitude of the acceleration induced by gravity, and the minus sign is there to indicate the downward direction of the acceleration. Now remember, we're going to put in g for the moon, not for the Earth. So we start subbing things in. Well, we're trying to find the flight time for the entire flight, and the final y value for the entire flight is zero. We know the initial y value is zero. In other words, we're implicitly putting the origin at the ground level. Now we sub in the initial y velocity, that was 32.7. So we have 32.7 t minus 1/2 g, which for this problem is 1.63 meters per second squared, times t squared. Now one solution of this quadratic equation is t equals zero. We can just see that by inspection, because if I sub in t equals zero, it makes the equation true. And this solution is valid because what happened there is the math just told us at t equals zero, y is equal to zero. It's just that we're not interested in that particular solution. We want to know the other time where y is equal to zero. So what we're going to do here is just divide one of these t's out of the equation, and it leaves us with a nice linear equation. We get zero equals 32.7 minus, and I'll go ahead and multiply the 1/2 into the 1.63 here, minus 0.815 times t. Now if we solve for t, we're going to get the time for which the projectile lands. And to three significant digits, that comes out to about 40.1 seconds. Next, we're going to get the range for the golf ball, in other words, the horizontal distance traveled during the flight. And the key point about this horizontal component of the motion is that the speed never changes. This thing is going to keep moving along at 25.5 meters per second to the right for the entire flight. And that's because there are no forces acting horizontally on the golf ball, so there's no acceleration in that direction. So to describe the motion horizontally, we can write down x equals x naught, the initial x coordinate, plus the initial x velocity, so v naught x, times how long it does this for. And that's the flight time t that we got in part A. So we're implicitly putting the origin at the starting point for this ball. So x naught is going to be zero. And the final x value, that's what we call the range, capital R. So we'll get the range from our initial x velocity of 25.5 meters per second. And we'll multiply that by the flight time, 40.1 seconds. Again, there was no acceleration term there. There's no 1/2 at squared because there's no acceleration in the x direction. So we paid attention to units on this one just so we could see the seconds cancel there. And we get units of meters in the final answer. And we end up with about 1,023 meters And if we're going to stay faithful to our usual habit of rounding everything to three significant digits, we'll just go ahead and round that off to 1,020. So this is how fun it would be to play golf on the moon. I think this shot would be like a typical mid-iron, and it just flew over a kilometer. So next we move on to part C, where we're trying to find the maximum height of the ball. And there are basically two ways to approach this problem. Because the flight of our projectile is completely symmetric, because we're on a level surface, we could just take half the flight time and then plug that time into the y equation to find out what the height is at that moment. But I'm going to focus on a more direct method, and this method also generalizes to asymmetric flight paths. The key physical point about the top of the trajectory is that Vy is equal to zero there. Now we can use the time-independent kinematics equation. Vy squared is V0y squared plus 2ay times y minus y naught. And we're going to sub everything in here. So like our final y velocity is going to be zero. Our initial y coordinate is going to be zero. And then we still have to sub in the acceleration caused by gravity here. So we end up with zero equals my initial y velocity squared. So 32.7 squared. And then the acceleration term is going to be negative because our acceleration points downward. And I end up with a minus 2 times 1.63, just moving the minus sign out in front of that term, multiplied by my final y coordinate, which we could just call y max. So when we solve for y max in our calculator, we end up with 328 meters for the maximum height. Finally, in part D, we're asked to find the speed at the top of the trajectory. And you might be able to find some way to show a bunch of work on this, but that's not my intent. This is really just a concept question. I know at the top of the trajectory that Vy is equal to zero, so the y component of velocity vanishes. I also know that Vx, the x component of the velocity, never changes. So Vx is equal to V0x. That means this velocity at the top of the trajectory, the total velocity here, is just equal to the initial x velocity. And I showed that as a vector to indicate that it still has the initial rightward direction. Now, what we were actually asked in part D was just for the speed, so we don't have to worry about the direction. The speed at the top of the trajectory is just equal to the magnitude of our initial x velocity, and that's 25.5 meters per second. So if you enjoy talking about kinematics on the moon, I actually made a second video for this short series about the Apollo 15 mission, where an astronaut dropped a hammer and a feather in a vertical free fall experiment. I'll post a link to that video at the upper left, and I'll see you there.